It is for a wider area, whole of India or whole of South Asia, whole of Western Hemisphere, something like that. Okay, and the seasonal changes are quite broader and they are not sudden. Okay, the changes you can make out for a longer period and they are being measured for the longer span of time. Okay, so why we are bothered about the climate and climate change? So the weather patterns, what it has been earlier, now they start changing slowly. New weather patterns are setting and it is happening in the past one century. Okay, earlier also it has happened, but what we are concerned with is what is happening in the past one century. Okay, there are five components with this climate and climate change. What are they? They are atmosphere, hydrosphere, cryosphere, biosphere and lithosphere. So all these atmosphere, hydrosphere, cryosphere and lithosphere, they are the physical entities, whereas biosphere is the living entity. Okay, why I am emphasizing on this? It's because of these living organisms that changes are taking place in all other physical forms. So what are the major effects or major changes that are taking place or major causes, the process that are taking place in climate change? The main one is the solar radiation. Okay, the energy that we got, that we are getting from the sun, okay, that is the main source of this global warming and climate change. And ocean currents, they are doing good, and I'll explain you in the subsequent slides how it is doing good. And evaporation, the water which is being getting evaporated from the water bodies as well as through the plants and many surfaces. And volcanic activity, the energy, heat energy that comes from within the earth, so that also contributes to this climate change. When you, these are all the abiotic factors. When you come to biotic factors, transpiration of the water through plants from the earth to the atmosphere, and respiration of the plants and animals, taking the oxygen and releasing the carbon dioxide, and photosynthesis, which is positive, which takes carbon dioxide, absorbs the carbon dioxide by the plants and releasing oxygen, and decomposition, which is negative due to bacterial putrefaction and many of the spoilages, the methane, nitrous oxide, all these greenhouse gases that are being released into the atmosphere, all these causes the climate change. Okay, as I said now, that solar radiation is the main energy source to the earth. Okay, when the ecological balance is there, nothing happens. But when the solar, when the heat energy that is coming from sun is getting reflected within insulation on the in the atmosphere of the earth, the warming of the earth is taking place. I hope you are, almost all of you are aware of how this global warming is taking place. So this global warming, when the heat energy is getting increased on the earth, it is global warming. Global cooling also, it happened in the geological period, that is called as ice ages. That was natural. Global warming and global cooling, that was taking place in the geological period. But now what we are concerned with is the global warming that is taking place due to the human interference. So there was a movie some years back, maybe 15 years back, there was a Hollywood movie, The Day After Tomorrow. It's a science fiction movie in which the imagination was picturized in a very beautiful manner. So this is the top of the some 110th floor of some that has skyscraper in New York, that building. Okay, so the ice has gone up to the top of that building. So that is, it's quite thrilling. That picture is thrilling. Later you can see the title of the movie is The Day After Tomorrow. So it is based on this global cooling, ice formation, right? There were some cartoon movies on this Ice Age 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. Okay, so what I mean to say is global warming started many millions of years back. Even the sea level rose 120 meters during several millennia after the Ice Age. The last ice age known to science was approximately 21,000 years ago. Okay, after that the global climate, it got stabilized. But the problem happened in the 20th century, during which the sea level increase is taking place slowly, mainly because of the global warming and the glacier melting and the increasing volume of the sea water and all of the water, hydrosphere. Okay, so climate change, it may be due to both natural causes and man-made causes. We cannot do anything about the natural causes. One of the well-known natural causes are like El Nino, La Nina. Okay, the El Nino, when it happens once in 3 to 7 years. Okay, when the El Nino takes place, the whole of the climate of the globe is being affected, and it not only affect the seas and oceans, particularly the South Pacific area, it even the terrestrial environments, they are being affected, because the earth is completely insulated with atmosphere, which are interconnected, both seas and the atmosphere, they are interconnected in terms of temperature, right? So what the problem is, the man-made cause, that is called as the external variability, right? The natural causes, internal variability, or internal variabilities, natural causes, and the external variability is the man-made causes that are making havoc in the past one century. Gradually the temperature is start increasing. Here is a comparison of planets and the atmosphere. Okay, particularly the carbon dioxide, the amount of quantum of carbon dioxide plus other gases also, that determines the temperature on any planet. For example, here in Mars, the planet Mars, it has thin atmosphere and almost all carbon dioxide, they are in the ground, they are not in the atmosphere. So the average temperature is minus 50 degree centigrade. Whereas in the case of Earth, the atmosphere is to some extent saturated with carbon dioxide, and average temperature is plus 15 degree centigrade. This is average temperature. The range may be 0 or minus to 45 degrees, some places even 50 degrees in deserts and all, maybe 50 degrees in the tropical areas. And you see another planet, Venus, the atmosphere is thick and totally saturated, 96% saturated with carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. Because of that, it's so hot. The average temperature is plus 420 degrees centigrade. So average means maximum may be around 500 or 600 degrees. Okay, so which is not at all suitable for human habitation. And this planet is also not suitable for human or any living organism. Okay, so what I mean to say is carbon dioxide and other gases, they determine the heat energy of any planet. So this is how it happens. The greenhouse gases, there is a sort of insulation, and whatever the solar energy we are getting, it is getting reflected back and back again, and then so gradually due to this repeated reflections, the heat energy is retained on the earth. Instead of it is getting freed into the atmosphere, they are getting entrapped on the global atmosphere. So this is the heat budget. So some solar radiation goes out, but mostly they are getting arrested within the atmosphere because of this greenhouse gases plus the humidity, moisture. So in combination with that, it makes the global warming. And if you see the data that has been collected in the past one century from 1870 to 2000, so the carbon dioxide atmosphere, global atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide, it was around 290 or so in 1870, and now it has reached around 400 ppm. Okay, so corresponding carbon dioxide, methane and the nitrous oxide. So the data collected shows that there is a steep increase in all these gases from the year 1800, 900, so it's 1900 to 2000. Between this period, there is a steep increase in all these gases, which are mainly due to industrialization. Okay, so accordingly or correspondingly, the temperature, it started increasing. So what are all these greenhouse gas emissions? What are the sources? So the major source are the energy production systems, industries, even agriculture, forestry, waste and wastewater, transportation, whatever the mode of transportation, flight or train or road transport, and our own residential and commercial buildings. So all these contribute to this greenhouse gases and global warming. And here is a projection. If the climate change projected for the year 2100, if the economic development or the growth, if it is rapid, by the year 2100, the global warming will be much, much more. If the economic growth is slower, okay, relatively the global warming will be less. This is a scientific projection. Okay, this cautions us how we have to go about further. We cannot totally stop the developments, but at the same time, we have to take care of carbon emission and many other gas emissions. So this is actually the just to have an understanding about how the carbon from the atmosphere, it goes to the earth, and from the earth, how it goes back to the atmosphere like a cycle through various processes, including the biological organisms, both plants and animals. Okay, this volcanic eruption, combustions, okay, combustion of the fossil fuels, right, organic decomposition of the animal waste, dead animals, plants, from that also the methane and the nitrous oxide and carbon dioxide, all this, they are being released, plant respiration, okay. And the good one is assimilation of the plant and mainly the ocean, particularly the phytoplankton, they assimilate this carbon dioxide, and because of that, we have not gone into the serious problem of consequences of climate change. Otherwise, it would have been very, very difficult for the existence of living organisms on the globe. So this is sort of a bit more chemistry on this carbon cycle, how it is happening. And the good news is that whatever the carbon, now the efforts are being made to capture the carbon and bury them, capturing the carbon and burying them into the earth. It is being taking place, and it is, of course, it is not very common, but the efforts are being taken by the developed countries. So the unused the spaces which are in deep in, into the earth, they can be used as a storage for this carbon capturing and burning. So what are all the major effects which are taking place? So mainly the earth's temperature increases, polar ice is melting, because of that the migration of the polar organisms and many things. Not only polar organisms, many terrestrial forms, the migration is taking place, disease outbreaks are taking place, and because of the melting of the glacier, the sea level rises because of the increased volume of the water in the seas and oceans. Okay, because of that low elevated small island countries and the coastal areas, they start slowly submerging. Some small islands have already disappeared in the Pacific area, and in our own country near Mandapam, and the seasons have changed, longer summers and disrupted animal habitation, new and widespread disease because of this warming. Just 1 degree centigrade increase or 2 degree centigrade, that will make devastation in the whole of the physiology of the plants and animals, and crop damage due to that because of this climate change, flooding, rain, heat wave, drought, extreme winters, storms, hurricanes and wildfires. So the assessment report of the 4th International Panel on Climate Change confirms that global warming is strongly affecting biological system, and that 20 to 30% of species, they are in the risk of extinction from projected future increases in temperature. Okay, in the next maybe 100 years, 20 to 30% of the species, they may disappear. Already I have read in the past 50 years, about 40% of the phytoplankton, they have gone out. So this is today's news. Okay, today's news, forest fire in California, it's in Tamil, but I think any news TV channel, if you watch today evening, you can see that. So how climate change, this is the agriculture is our main food production system. So when climate change is affecting the environment, so the next main entity that is being affected is agriculture, the main food production system. Okay, then comes the fisheries, animal husbandry, all they are like chain reaction, they are interlinked with each other. And finally, the very livelihood of the human beings, they are being affected. Agriculture, we may see, there are two things. Agriculture itself is contributing to the greenhouse gases and affecting the climate. Climate, because of the climate change takes place, and climate change is impacting on agriculture. Both the things are happening, right? So how agriculture contributes to the climate change? By anthropogenic, human activities of emissions of the greenhouse gases in agriculture, and by converting the natural forest, that is non-agricultural land, into agricultural land. When the ratio kept increasing from the forest to agriculture, okay, correspondingly these greenhouse gas emissions, they also increase. So here you see about 20 to 25% of the global annual emission in the year 2010, it was due to agriculture and forestry and land use changes. So here again a graph that shows you how much industry, agriculture, forestry and land use together, buildings, transport and energy, other energies. So they are the direct emissions and indirect emissions. Okay, 30% of the total global anthropogenic emissions, they are due to the agricultural activities. How in agriculture, burning the leftover in the agricultural fields, clearing by fire and this burning the residues. Okay, and what all this animal husbandry and as well as tilling, when we are doing plowing the agricultural land, the bacteria that are trapping all this methane and nitrous oxide, they get released into the atmosphere, and that is how it's happening. And we, the organisms, animals, including human beings, we release methane not only through flocculation, but burping also. We release gas into the atmosphere that includes methane, right? All because of the bacterial putrefaction which are happening in the microbiome. Okay. So emissions from livestock production vary. That globally it has been estimated how much of amount of carbon dioxide and methane and all these they are getting released into the atmosphere due to the livestock and animals all over the globe. The developing world accounts for 70% of the emission, because developing world, they are the main food producers. Wherever the food production from agriculture, animal husbandry, or even fishery, inland fisheries, wherever it is taking place, the emission correspondingly it takes place. So impact of climate change on agriculture. Even there, if there is a 1 degree centigrade of temperature increase, so that will affect 4 to 5 million tons of wheat production. Okay. And there are some good things about this global warming and climate change. Because of the increase in temperature, the frost, the cold formation and frost damage, that is getting reduced. Okay, wherever the frost damage was happening to the crops, now it is getting reduced. But the more of damage is due to the warming, that is more widely it is taking place all over the globe, particularly not only directly the increase in temperature, but indirectly due to droughts, floods, rains, etc. So there is a projection that by the year 2100, the cereal production, it will be reduced to from 10 to 40%. Okay, so you can imagine, when the population, human population, is keeping on increasing, the food production, if it start decreasing, then you can imagine the situation what will happen. And particularly the rice eaters, we like India, we are very much worried about the production of rice. So many varieties of rices are there, and many of them, even with 1 degree temperature increase, they will get affected, and their very production and sterility, stunted growth, disease outbreak, all this happens. And even if you get the grains, the quality of the grain becomes bad, it becomes chalky. The quality of the, it cannot be stored with the normal grain storing process. Okay, so again, this is 23rd August, Times of India press cutting, in which the CREDA scientists, they have come out with the scientific data, how it is going to, the rice yield is going to be affected in our country from the study spanning 17 states they have made, including Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and all. And rice yield based on 6.2 million simulations of climate change and the global warming. So with the simulation studies, they have made out the rice production will come down like anything in the years to come. So all depends. It's not only rice, any plant. Okay. So they have their own physiological limitations with the physicochemical parameters. And if that is getting affected, the whole of the physiology, whether it is plant or animal, it's happening. This is one good example in Uganda. Now it's having good suitable areas for coffee production. What you see, the brown ones. Okay. If the temperature increases to 2 degrees centigrade after some years, okay, you can see the brown patches have gone down like anything. So totally the area is not suitable for the coffee production. This is just one example of one crop. So there may be hundreds of this type of investigations available when the climate change is happening. So what we have to do, we have to go for modifications in our agricultural system and development of climate resilient varieties of crops. Okay, our tilling process should be modified. Okay, and what all our agriculture the process activities are to be modified. That is called the climate resilient technological modifications and climate resilient varieties of crops as well as fishes or whatever it is. Okay, so this good impact is also there. As I said, the frost damage that is also getting reduced, that's a good news. But the flood and other things that are affecting, and climate change adaptations it includes many things, right from technical aspects up to the insurance. Okay, there are so many modifications that we will be compelled to adapt or to cope up with the climate change. So in the barren environment, see oceans and seas, they are 75% of the globe. So mainly the biodiversity also incomparably it is high in the seas and oceans, and the seas and oceans, they are the main route for trade, global trade, and many things. Even your cloud computer, whatever the data you put in the cloud, actually they are going below the sea, not in the cloud. They are going below the sea through these cables. So in that way, oceans and the seas, they are playing a very, very important role in the human utilization. And there are two things that are the danger points, danger phenomena that are taking place due to climate change. One is the rising ocean temperature and ocean acidification. This carbon dioxide produced, which are released into the atmosphere, that are getting dissolved into the seas and ocean, making the sea water into a light carbonic acid. Okay, because of this, the pH is getting reduced, and because of this, the ocean water is becoming more and more acidic. Okay, this acidification impacts on the aquatic organisms, particularly the phytoplankton. If you see the food web, the trophic triangle, okay, the phytoplankton is the base, zooplankton next, and primary consumers, secondary consumers, and the tertiary consumers. So the phytoplankton is the base. No animal can produce food, including human beings. We can buy food, we can cook food, but we cannot produce food. It requires photosynthesis. Only plants can do. In the terrestrial environment, in the aquatic environment, the same is happening. This phytoplankton, the floating micro plants, they are producing the food which are being transferred to the higher side of the trophic chain. Okay, so this again projection in the year 2100, how much the pH will get reduced, and because of this acidity will increase. But by looking at this, you may see it's only slight change in the pH. What is there to bother? No, it is to be bothered, because is the slightest change in the pH will also definitely affect, and it is affecting the organisms, the marine environment, but particularly the silicon and calcareous material in the fragile microorganisms, they are getting affected. And if you see the main energy, seas and ocean, they absorb 93% of the solar energy. Most of the energy from the sun, it is being absorbed by the oceans, buffering, making a buffering so that the animals and plants can survive on the earth. Otherwise, it will, if you imagine that there is no seas and oceans, by this time the earth might have got roasted like anything long time back. So ice is absorbing only about 4% of the energy that from sun, and atmosphere just 1%, land absorbs only 2%, So the rest of the 93% that is being absorbed by the seas and the oceans. Okay, so this El Nino I told about already. So warming of this seas, when warming takes place, what happens? In the tropical area, it becomes more warmer. Because of this, the animals and the plants, of course, mostly animals, okay, they cannot withstand when there is an increase in temperature, they start migrating. Whichever is able to migrate, they will migrate towards the polar region, that is polar regions. Whichever is not able to migrate, they will try to adapt physiologically. If they are not able to adapt, they die off. Okay, this is happening. And this is happening in the case of the salinity, saltish nature of the water in the seas and oceans. They are animals and plants, they are naturally adapted for this saltish nature in the seas and oceans. When there is a change in the salinity because of evaporation in the tropical belts and more of dilution in the polar regions due to melting of ice, what happens? This salinity changes also affects the organisms, and the acidity, the pH, how it affects coral reefs particularly, and calcium and silicon bearing organisms, all these, these are all the impacts that have been known to science that are taking place right now. Okay, the scientific evidence about sea level rise, this is an important issue nowadays, which is being debated very much all over the globe. And the global mean sea level rose as 1.5 mm per year in the beginning of the century, but now it is 3.6 or 4 mm per year, and it is likely to increase to 1 meter by the year 2100. So if this is going to be the sea level rise, it's not only the physical intrusion of the sea water into the low-lying areas and the coastal areas, it is intrusion of the sea water contaminating the freshwater aquifers in the earth inside the below. So even we may not be able to get the drinking water or the good water for agriculture, and it's like a chain reaction. So it's like we are blessed with warm water and deep water cold currents, warm water surface currents and deep water cold currents. So these are like arteries and veins in animals and human beings. So they distribute the heat, oxygen, nutrients and fresh water, and because of that the tropical areas, they have not got heated up more, and the polar regions, they have not got cooled down much. Okay, it is actually making the buffering all over the globe naturally thanks to these ocean currents. Not only global ocean tropical currents, the equatorial current, counter equatorial current, even the local currents that are playing a major role in bringing the nutrients from the bottom to the surface, and primary production, secondary production, and finally the fishery production. The famous upwelling that are taking place along Argentina and all. And melting of these glaciers, so it happens slowly. At one place, if it starts, it makes a funnel-like structure, and because of this funnel-like structure, then the ice start melting fast, lubricating and taking out all of the ice, and then it breaks into big pieces, and they start floating away from the polar region, or they can melt up over there. So you might have seen so many documentaries, BBC Earth, Sony BBC Earth, National Geographic, and all this, and YouTube also you can find all this. And in a couple of years back, 2019, Uttarakhand glacier burst. It is a very much apparent event that has happened because of this climate change, right? And here is a witty photograph in which it is assumed that by the year 2030 the sea will come closer to the land, and by 2050 it will be still closer to the land in the beaches. And this is one investigation done by some American agency about Chennai. even in Chennai, some of the parts of Chennai, they will submerge. But we are enjoying a good place with a lot of residential buildings and all, getting fresh water after, by the year 2050, not very far, by the year 2050, they may get intruded with the seawater because of this sea level rise. This is a scientific projection made out of the data released by NASA. So fisheries is important one which is very much affected by this climate change, global warming, sea level rise and ocean acidification. So the changes in the temperature, very temperature of the seas, that will affect the aquatic organisms through by affecting the metabolism, growth rate, reproduction and the tolerance for disease and the toxins and all. So when the aquatic organisms, particularly the fishery, when it is being affected, then the whole of the coastal area that are depending on the fishery, okay, their livelihood is being affected, right? I think about 50% of the global human population, they are very much there in the coastal areas within 8 meters or something like that. There are so much of data. And what I mean to say is, the human settlement is always near the water, whether it is sea or rivers, lakes, reservoirs, you can see that. Okay, because we need water for every activity. So when people are settled in the coastal areas and when there is a sea level rise or the ecosystem is getting affected, then finally we are getting affected. Okay, if you see the trend of fish production, fishery production, there are two main production, capture fisheries and aquaculture. Earlier it was capture fisheries only, hunting the fishes from the natural waters, because we thought we will get the fish, whatever we take, we will get the fish due to the biological renewal. But it is not true. So the time came that the natural populations in the seas, the fishery population in the sea, they started stabilizing or dwindling. Because of that, we were compelled, 50 years back, we were compelled to think about producing the fish in captivities to supplement the increasing demand of the fishes all over the world. Okay, that is how the aquaculture production, they start increasing to meet the demand of the human beings. The per capita consumption of fish is also increasing. You see the green one, per capita consumption. Okay, that is also increasing. Because when compared to chicken, mutton and all, nowadays doctors say take fish. Okay, it is good for health globally. Okay, now we start taking much of fish and no fish in the sea. So we are compelled to go for aquaculture. And in addition to pollution, plastic pollution and all, climate change is also posing a problem to the fishery. These are all the different fishing zones which are demarcated for data collection purpose by the FAO, just for your knowledge, I am showing it. Major marine fishing areas and also 8 major river basins from which the data that supports many fishery, and many fishery they have collapsed also. Peruvian anchovies and all, they have collapsed in the past 1 century. And ocean acidification, how it is affecting particularly these shellfish, the fishes or the aquatic organisms which are having external skeleton which are made of chitin, chitosan or the calcareous material, silicon, all this, they are in danger. They are much affected by this ocean acidification, right? And zooplankton, they are the link in the chain, trophic chain. Phytoplankton, zooplankton. When the zooplankton, when they are affected because of this ocean acidification, there is a crack in the food chain. And you can imagine when there is a crack in the food chain, the whole of the energy transfer from the autotrophs to the final consumer, that is being disrupted. And this is another good example in Africa, where the people, their livelihood was depending upon the corals, the corals as such, and the animals which are associated with the corals. But because of this climate change and ocean acidification and ocean warming, increasing temperatures that have killed the corals over there, because of that coral bleaching took place. Once the coral bleaching takes place, it becomes like a desert in the sea. The whole of the organisms have, they go up, disappear. And because of that, the livelihood, very livelihood of the people in the Eastern African country, right, that they are being affected, like Kenya, Tanzania, Madagascar, Seychelles, Mauritius, they are all the island countries. Their main revenue is fishery and whatever comes from the sea. Okay, when the climate change is affecting that, the whole livelihood economy is affected. And whatever the nutrient load that goes into the sea due to the human activities, right, that also causes devastating effect to the biological organisms in the oceans and seas, particularly the oxygen depletion. And see these red dots, they are the oxygen depleted areas, and these blue areas are the a bit dangerous area, they may also get depleted totally, right? So this is that food chain, profit chain in terms of fishery. Whatever the primary produce production, then it is affected, then subsequently it affects the main fish production. And even the geographical change in the school of fishes, it takes place. Supposing if the situation is not so good in one particular area, the whole of the fish mass, they start moving towards the other places which are conducive for them to live. Because of that, the fishery is getting collapsed and the livelihood is being affected. So it may be due to natural causes, and it is also recorded, it has been investigated that due to some climate change and man-made pollution also, it's taking place. Okay, some examples from India, right? This shift in the spawning period that has been found to be in the fish threat fin brain, that has been found to be an example of this climate change. And Indian oil sardine, distribution of Indian oil sardine and Indian mackerel, once they were 50 years back, they were very much abundant in the west coast only, not in the east coast. But nowadays we are getting these fishes very much in the east coast also. So that one assumption is it is due to that climate change. And distribution of the tuna fish, skipjack tuna, migration due to the temperature variation, that is also being affected. These are some of the investigations, examples that due to climate change in Indian fisheries that is taking place. In aquaculture, the same, the organisms which are being cultured in captivity, in a controlled condition, they are also susceptible for impact through physiology due to this hypoxia, sea level rise, temperature variation, precipitation, and ocean acidification. In addition to that, because of this climate change, the extreme events are taking place, like frequent rains, cyclones and all. Because of this, these type of structures, they are getting damaged. Okay, I'll show you. SIBA also, we did the investigations. I'll show you the photographs. So it's not only in the marine environment, in freshwater environment also, all this, they are taking place. Flooding, drought, river flow, change in the river flow, lake water level. It's not only sea water level, lake water level also getting changed. So because of that, the animals, plants and animals, they are being affected. And finally, we are affecting, getting affected. And so now climate resilient technologies and the climate resilient varieties we have to grow, not only in agriculture, in aquaculture or in fishery. In aquaculture particularly, now we are compelled to go for selective breeding of particular strains which can tolerate higher temperature in the next 40-50 years, and which can tolerate this disease outbreak because of the increase in temperature. So all this we have to anticipate, and the research, anticipatory research is being started, and we have to be ready for that. So the physical damages that are also taking place, as I just now told, mainly due to these cyclones, frequent cyclones, okay, erosion of the in the pond structures, heavy siltation, damage to electrical insulation, sluice gates, shutters, screens, and associated negative impacts in the salinity, heavy siltation, introduction of new diseases and predators, all these have been recorded because of this. So these photographs I have taken long time back in 2004, immediately after tsunami near Nagapattinam. That was the most affected area because of tsunami, and we all, ICRC Fishery Institute scientists, we were sent immediately, and I was fortunate enough to go to Nagapattinam. I could see with my own eyes the damages that have caused by the tsunami. And of course, tsunami is not an impact of climate change. It is a natural happening. At any time, it may happen. It is not due to climate change. Just to show you how the damages, they are taking place, if the damages are due to cyclone, it is equivalent to the damages are equivalent to tsunami when cyclone takes place. So one good thing about the, we have trees which are absorbing the carbon dioxide in the terrestrial environment and helping to combat this climate change impact, right? Likewise, in the sea, we have whales, the wonderful organisms, the giants, that help us to combat the climate change. How they are doing? That is called as whale pump, right? These whales, they feed at the bottom, okay? And they are marine mammals, they are not fishes. Marine mammals, they have lungs like we human beings. They have to come up to take oxygen, air, atmospheric air. So frequently, when they come up, they release the air with carbon dioxide or whatever it is into the atmosphere. So that is not the good news, that is the bad news. Okay, but the good news is they defecate the whatever the digested food, they defecate, and this fecal matter, they contain lot of nutrients. These nutrients are immediately available to the phytoplankton, and these phytoplankton, in the presence of very good high levels of nutrients, they do photosynthesis and they produce food by absorbing carbon dioxide. So it is like a chain reaction, right? High nutrients, photosynthesis, increased photosynthesis by phytoplankton, and more absorption of carbon dioxide. So this is actually how it is happening. Phytoplankton, they absorb maximum carbon dioxide globally. So you can consider one whale is worth thousands of trees, right? If you consider this, that they are combating, helping to combat the climate change carbon emission now. So this is a concept, wet bulb temperature concept. What is it, wet bulb temperature? See, wet bulb temperature, which is denoted as TW, is 35 degree centigrade with hot and humid situation. In a simple term, I can tell, hot and humid situation with a record of 35 degree centigrade. So this is a dangerous temperature that will create lot of problem, increasing the disease outbreaks, bacterial propagation, so many outbreaks of diseases, so many things, inconvenience, okay. So this is actually happening in the 21st century, and already, okay, some coastal subtropical locations have already reported this wet bulb temperature with extreme humid and hot situation from 1979 onwards. Okay, so in the recently this global maximum sea surface temperature also that shows that this type of why it is called as wet bulb temperature. See, in meteorology there is a device called as hygrometer. Hygrometer, H-Y-G-R-O, hygrometer, which is used to measure the humidity in the atmosphere. Okay, it's a very common, very simple equipment device which has simply two thermometers, normal thermometer. Okay, the one is a thermometer without a wet cloth, and another one is a thermometer with a wet cloth, and that cloth is having connection with just a small container with water. Okay, so this wet bulb, what happens due to continuous evaporation when the humidity is less, okay, when the humidity is less, evaporation is more, it pulls down the temperature. Okay, so that means if you keep a dry bulb and a wet bulb, if the temperature difference is much, what it shows, the humidity is less, it is not humid. When both are equal, it is very, very humid. That is the wet bulb temperature. Okay, 35 degrees, it will be 35 degrees with a maximum humidity, maybe around 80 or 90 in the humidity, it will be equal. That's why it is called as wet bulb temperature. So what we have to do? So we cannot blame the governments or the scientists why it has happened like that. You should have taken care like that. We cannot blame now, because economic development, it has to take place. It has been so much of economic developments, industrialization had to take place. Because of that only we have computers now and we have many things now. So we cannot blame that. But what we have to see is how we can further proceed with our scientific developments or economic developments without causing much harm to the environment, particularly emission of the carbon dioxide, methane and CFCs or whatever it is. Okay, so what are the things we have to do? Reduce the emission of greenhouse gases. Attempt to develop alternative energies. Okay, conventional energy, we should not, fossil fuel energy, we should not depend upon. We have to skip from fossil fuel to non-conventional energy. Allow emissions to continue but prepare for global climate change. Means we have to go for climate resilient processes and varieties, technologies, and allow emissions to continue as normal and leave preparation up to individual countries. This is not advisable, individual countries. It's a global issue. All countries to some extent we have to be in tune with each and every country and do something about it. Combine any of this, as I said now, come up with your own unique plans. Of course, in the years to come, lot of new technologies will come. And how to mitigate, how to fight. See, natural causes we cannot fight, but this is man-made cause. We can mitigate whatever possible, like reducing the source of these greenhouse gases and enhancing the sink. Already oceans, forests and soils, they are naturally they are the sinks for this carbon dioxide and other, but we have to try to capture more of the carbon dioxide and bury more of this carbon dioxide and all, and avoid significant human interference with the climate system. We should not keep on increasing these greenhouse gases. That is the main thing. And there are so many methods of carbon sequestration available in the internet, if later you can see. So geoengineering technologies that involves carbon capturing and storage, it is called as CCS. So first, carbon dioxide is, it is being removed from the industrial effluents in the atmosphere, in the source itself, and then they are being packed. When after packaging, it looks like a rock. Okay, there are so many YouTube videos are available in YouTube. Later you can see how you can pack the carbons and store them. And carbon emission, here you see the global carbon emission, who are doing more and who are doing less. So unfortunately, sadly, we, India, we are in the third position. China is number one, USA is number two. We, India, in third position, maybe due to our agricultural activities, may not be due to industrialization, but maybe due to agricultural activities, it may be like that. And here is a pie chart that indicates China 29%, USA 16%, India 7%, rest of the world 19%, so on, Japan, Germany. Okay, so this keeps changing also slightly. There is a specific website in that country-wise, year-wise, from 10 years back, how much they emitted, now how much they are emitting, country-wise you can see in the internet. So what are the alternative energies from hydropower, solar power mainly? So thank God we have been using the solar panels for many years, and of course some 10 years or 15 years or 20 years we are using the wind power also for tapping the energy, and these are all, to some extent, they are compensating our fossil fuel consumption reduction. Okay, so solar, hydro, wind, wave energy, tidal energy from the seas, thermal stratification in the sea, there are so many technologies available, but only thing is we have to work out the economics. When it comes to economics, then how far we can utilize the technologies, that question comes, right? So whatever possible, we have to slowly go for that technologies if we want to combat the climate change. So now we hear the terms like climate shock, climate migration of human beings. Okay, climate shock is taking place because of the drought, heat, and many changes, and people start moving from one area to another area, mainly because of this desertification and many or flooding and like that. Okay, I am happy to say that government of Tamil Nadu, see, government of Tamil Nadu, very recently the new government, they have allotted some good funds for this climate mitigation and adaptation strategies. And now there is a tie-up is going on with the Danish government to set up windmills in the sea, because in the sea the wind energy is more than compared to the land areas. So that wind energy can be utilized for energy production. So that talk is going on, that has come in newspaper only this month. And here are some examples I used to come across in Facebook and reading things. So Dutch trains run entirely on wind energy. Wind energy, they are converting into electricity, and this electricity that is being used. And we are also having electric trains, but here the electricity is being produced exclusively from wind energy, and then they are being used for this thing, for automobiles or whatever it is. And sea waves. This is a screenshot from a video I just saw a few days back. So you may see that video in YouTube, electricity from sea waves. You can see how it works. With the movement of the waves, the mechanical energy can be turned into electrical energy. Okay, so there's transportation. I said lot of carbon emission takes place from the aeroplanes, particularly the jet planes, supersonic, the sound is so high and the carbon emission is also so high, because when they are attaining so much of speed, right, within a short period, this Concorde, thank God it was decommissioned in the year 1985 or so, and but the fighter jets we have not decommissioned because of the defense purpose. And these are all high carbon emitting vehicles. Okay, so in the future, it started electrical aeroplanes. Now they started developing electrical aeroplanes, and maybe about 30, 40 years, 50 years, the passenger aeroplanes, they will be, I think, electrical aeroplanes. maybe you people may be able to see youngsters. And whatever the food we are getting, that also comes with a tag of carbon footprint. So don't buy imported fruits, vegetables and all. New Zealand pear, Washington apple, okay, the price is so high. A kilo 400 rupees, 500 rupees. It's not only the money cost, but it also comes with a lot of carbon footprint. Means it has to come by flight or by ship, and a lot of carbon is emitted because of this transportation. So eat locally, use cycles, right? There are so many things. And better go for reforestation so that carbon dioxide maximum it can be absorbed. In Brazil, one husband and wife, in about 20 years, they have developed forests like this. This is just one example. There are tree men in India also, in Kerala and Bihar also. There are so many people you might have heard about, you may be knowing. So we can also do that, each and every one of us. We can have a target of planting with our own community, the trees wherever possible around our house, around our roadsides, okay? But if we do not do that, if the sea level goes like anything, this is one hilarious painting in which you see that we have to break our heads with a meeting when the sea has gone up, submerging all our cities. So when you talk about the climate resilient technologies, one the researchers, one group of researchers from one institute in Israel, including one institute in Israel, they have bioengineered and developed a bacterial strain that exclusively consumes carbon dioxide. Okay, so this is just one example. Nobody knows, in future we may come out with many such a technological development so that carbon is being consumed by the plants and animals, so that the carbon is level is reduced and the climate. It's not only talking about climate change. So climate action should go. You all know about Greta Thunberg. This little girl started that. And all over the world, the youngsters, we are very much doing that. And climate action, pro-climate policies and governance, all that are taking place in our country also. So I would like to conclude it with a quote from Charles Darwin. So whatever the species which can withstand, which can stay for many years in the world, it's not because of its strength or the intelligence, but it's because of its ability to withstand the changing environment, that is the climate change. So let us save the climate, save the environment, so that we can save our human beings and our all co-inhabitants of this earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. You have presented very useful information, not only about the overall climate and also how to control this climate change aspect to sustain our agriculture activities as a whole. So we all, whoever present in this presentations, we have learned this topic, saying that climate change world is very, you know, to hear, but very tough to address in our daily activities. So you have addressed not only the issues what is coming today, even the issues how we can control down in the near future. So once again, thank you so much, sir, for very useful presentations. And this presentation also will be available in our Aquadoctor Solution YouTube channel in a recorded form, so that later on other viewers also can get blessed by yours these presentations. So without much wasting the time, I like to request from our audience, maybe one or two questions will be addressing, because sir is having another presentation in a short while, as I know. So we'll just take one or two questions from the audience side to just directly you can ask to question to sir, please.
Sir, very good information, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Rajaparkam.
Sir, you told about the acidification of coral reefs, sir, how it is climate change affecting coral reefs in marine environment.
Yeah. Yeah, see, it's mainly because of two phenomena, that is increase in temperature and acidification. Okay, because of this, when the temperature increases in the water, okay, that affects the calcium content of the corals. And acidity, in combination with acidity, a decrease in acidity. When the organisms, when they are affected, the whole organisms, they die out. And because of that, only whatever they have constructed the corals, they are there and they start becoming white. When the organisms are there, they are colorful. Corals are beautifully colorful. When the organisms are not there, whatever is left is the calcareous material, what they have constructed, and like a burial ground it looks. Okay.
Thank you, sir. That is called the coral bleaching.
Yeah, coral bleaching.
Any more question?
No.
Yeah. Hello. Good evening.
Hello. Good evening. How are you?
Hi. Asahaji. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. It's a nice presentation.
Thank you.
This is a burning topic. Hello?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, it's a burning topic. People are very much aware of, especially the deforestation.
Yes.
The Ghats, Western Ghats, the Himalayan region, and once these supposed to be Madhya Pradesh and all that, very large areas of forest used to be there, but now it is getting so much of desertification.
Yeah.
It's a good topic. They say that one side there could be land being exposed and the sea being exposed and the other side land being submerged, something like that.
No, that has happened in the case of tsunami. After in Andaman, what has happened because of the jerk that was so severe that in Andaman some areas which were submerged in water, they got exposed, and which were exposed, they got submerged. Because of that, the whole of the, that has happened. But sea level rise, it keeps on uniformly increasing. It is submerging only in the coastal areas. In the particular.
The Somnathpur, the temple area, and all, they say that it was very much exposed to the Dwarka. Dwarka, this one they say, right?
I think if there is no more question, we can conclude our session today.
Okay, thank you.
I think I will conclude the session by saying three lines to Shishri.
Okay.
The way Tal expressed, saying that human interventions are creating problems in our ocean and sea, I will say that human intervention also now creating problems in our Indian aquaculture as well. Because we are using unconditionally lots of fertilizer, lots of medicines, and lots of feeding management, by which directly or indirectly we are polluting our soils and our water, and we are unknowingly dispersing the water in our ecosystem, by which also we are creating lots of issues like pH certifications in many farming areas. Today we can see many areas pH balancing is a major issue in the farming sector. So I will address to the participants saying that climate change, not only the issue of temperature rising, is also associated with pollution aspects and the way we are managing our ecosystem. We need to be understand that ecosystem, when it is healthy, we are also healthy. When we are healthy, ecosystem also healthy. So we need to be depend each other. And with this word, I like to thank once again to Dr. V.S. Chandrasekaran sir to give a very nice presentation. And further that also, I like to convey my regards to A.K. Sahu sir from CIFA, but also other sir from Kuwait, because they are also the really, I should say, motivator for Sunday topic. Most of the time, sir, participants and boost up the sessions also. With this word, once again, thanks to V.S. Chandrasekaran sir for your valuable time. And this whole session also will be available in YouTube channel, so that in coming days, most of our students and our fellow aquaculture professionals also can benefit with this presentation. Thank you once again. Stay blessed, stay happy, and enjoy your Sunday evening. Thanks once again to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.